Hi, good afternoon. I'm sure you have heard the briefing by the Assistant Secretary General for Political Affairs the way I did. I have a couple of remarks to make. My first remark is that Assistant Secretary General has once again condoned and ignored addressing the issue of the Syrian Golan, occupied by the Israelis since 1967. Although the Syrian Golan is an integral part of the item on the situation in the Middle East, as you know, and it falls within his mandate, which is the Secretary General's mandate also, we have drawn the kind attention of the Secretary General many times to this very important point. We have got always promises that were not fulfilled with regard to respecting the mandate by incorporating a reference to the occupied Syrian Golan in each of the Secretariat briefings to the Council, something that didn't happen. This is really unfortunate. Number two, the second remark would go for what I would call an incomplete picture given by the Secretariat with regard to the very complex and complicated dimensions of the situation in the Middle East. You may have noticed that the Assistant Secretary General started addressing this very important and historical item by talking about events in Syria, rather than addressing the core issue, which is the Palestinian question and the Arab-Israeli conflict, and how would the Secretariat play a positive role in helping the parties towards sitting at the table of negotiations and settling this Arab-Israeli conflict based on the international legitimacy resolutions, as well as the Arab Peace Initiative and Madrid talks. So that was the second lacuna, I would say, in the briefing given by Mr. Taranko. The third remark would go for the following. Mr. Taranko has addressed many important topics and issues without giving a detailed description and an objective analysis. So he addressed, for instance, the issue of what he called the chemical weapons in Syria. He talked about the UNDOF and the Golan. He addressed the issue of this terrorist guy in Sidon in Lebanon. But he didn't give any clear, crystal-cut indication about the real motivations behind each one of these important topics. With regard to chemical weapons, he didn't say that the Syrian government has welcomed the arrival of a UN team headed by Dr. Selstrom anytime, any moment, in an hour from now or in 24 hours from now, to investigate what we had agreed upon together, which is the incident, the attack by the chemical weapons by the armed groups on Khan al-Asal in Aleppo, which was the core issue of the Syrian request to the Secretary General, to which the Secretary General had agreed in a written form to investigate. Then he retracted from his initial position under the pressure of the British and the French delegations. Why this pressure took place? It took place because the two countries, the two governments, were aware about who did it. So they had a great interest in not disclosing or revealing the real perpetrators of such appalling attack by the chemical weapons on Khan al-Assad. Then the UNDOF. I forwarded on behalf of my government more than 5 letters recently, lately speaking, on events that are taking place, that took place in the separation line in the occupied Syrian Golan. We drew the kind attention of the Secretary General as well as the members of the Council on the fact that the Qatari government is involved directly in manipulating and instructing the abductors, those who kidnapped the Filipinos' elements within the UNDOF force. We asked the Secretary General and the Security Council members to investigate about these Qatari flagrant and blatant involvement in this irresponsible act of provocation towards the safety and the security of the UN staff within the UNDOF. Mr. Taranko found it very suitable for him not to mention anything with this regard, as if the Secretariat is either incapable of doing something or would like to give a blind eye, turn a blind eye to this Qatari involvement. Then the issue of this crazy guy in Sidon, in Lebanon, who declared war on the Lebanese army and killed, as you know, 17 officers and soldiers. And then I don't know where he is right now, where he's whereabouts, but I'm sure that the Lebanese army at the end of the day will arrest him and will hold him as accountable and responsible for his criminal acts. But also all these very important details were not given by Mr. Taranko in his partial picture of the unfolding developments taking place right now in Lebanon. I wouldn't interfere in the Lebanese internal affairs. It's up to the Lebanese government to do what they have to do. But as Mr. El Ebrahimi said today in Geneva, what's going on in Lebanon is a direct outcome of what is going on in Syria and vice versa. The two governments of the two countries knew that long time ago, and this is why we signed treaties among the two governments with regard helping each other, confronting terrorism, and preventing the use of each other's territories as a passage of aggression against the other. So we have an arsenal of treaties, an arsenal of mutual agreements between the two governments that are regulating such activities. So we are not totally happy with the picture given by Mr. Taranko, because this picture, as I said, is incomplete and not balanced. Please.
ألمح رئيس مجلس الأمن الدولي مندوب بريطانيا إلى أن مؤتمر جنيف سيتأخر نتيجة لأن لعدم تجاوب الحكومة السورية أو للتصعيد العسكري الذي فعلته الحكومة السورية في الأزمة. هل ترون الأمور بهذا الشكل؟ هل تأخير مؤتمر جنيف أسبابه تعود إلى الحملة العسكرية السورية؟
شكرا. وزير الخارجية السوري بالأمس تحدث بإسهاب عن هذا الموضوع وقال بأن الحكومة السورية منذ فترة نقلت إلى الجهات التي تقوم بالتحضير من أجل عقد اجتماع جنيف، نقلت موافقتها على حضور الاجتماع، ووزيرنا أعلن هذا الأمر الحقيقة في بغداد خلال زيارته للعراق كما تذكر. فمشاركة سوريا، مشاركة الحكومة السورية في مؤتمر جنيف هي مشاركة مبدئية. نحن بالنسبة لنا اجتماع جنيف هو اجتماع مفيد لسوريا، لكل سوريا، لكل السوريين. طبعا هناك شروط يجب أن تتوافر في هذا الصدد، أهمها أن تأتي الأطراف الأخرى التي تقوم بالتحضير لهذا المؤتمر بوفد موحد يمثل المعارضة السورية لكي يجلسوا مع الحكومة ونضع حدا للعنف. طبعا يعني أهم بند هو وضع حد للعنف، ومن ثم التفاهم على حكومة وحدة وطنية تمثل مستقبل سوريا من خلال تلبية طموح ما يتفق عليه المفاوضون حول طاولة المؤتمر. هذه المرة سيكون هناك شهود السيد الإبراهيمي وأطراف أخرى ودول أخرى وحكومات أخرى. الحكومة السورية تنظر لمؤتمر جنيف أو لاجتماع جنيف نظرة جدية، ولكننا نريد لهذه الجدية أن تكون أيضا ماثلة وحاضرة في أذهان وسلوك وسياسات الأطراف الأخرى. الحكومة السورية ليست مسؤولة عن التصعيد، أنت تعرف أن التصعيد أتى مؤخرا، وقبل ذلك أيضا من خلال إرسال الإرهابيين الذين يسمون أنفسهم جهاديين عبر حدودنا المشتركة مع تركيا ولبنان والأردن. وهذه الحكومات، حكومات هذه الدول لا تقوم بما يجب عليها القيام به من أجل وقف هذا التسلل غير المشروع عبر حدودنا، وهو تسلل يحمل معه آفة الإرهاب وآفة التطرف كما تعرف. وأيضا مؤخرا أيضا كما تعرف رفع الحظر عن تسليح المعارضة من قبل الاتحاد الأوروبي، والقرار الأمريكي أيضا بتسليح الجماعات المسلحة. لا يمكن أن تكون مولعا بإشعال الحرائق من جهة وأن تدعي أنك أطفائي يريد إطفاء الحرائق من جهة أخرى. عليك أن تختار، إما أن تكون في هذا الجانب أو في ذاك الجانب. أنا أشرت في مداخلتي الأولى باللغة الإنجليزية إلى أن السيد تارانكو لم يقدم صورة كاملة للوضع المتعلق ببند الحالة في الشرق الأوسط. بند الحالة في الشرق الأوسط يتعلق أساسا وفقا للولاية الممنوحة للأمانة العامة بموجبه بالصراع العربي الإسرائيلي والقضية الفلسطينية. للأسف الأمانة العامة ورغم لفت عنايتها عدة مرات إلى واقع أنها ملزمة بحكم الولاية أن تذكر أو تقدم آخر التطورات الحاصلة في الجولان السوري المحتل، لكنها لم تفعل للأسف. فالسيد تارانكو اليوم عاد فكرر نفس الخطأ الذي وقعت فيه الأمانة العامة في إحاطاتها الشهرية أو الدورية لمجلس الأمن من خلال تجاهل ممثلي الأمانة العامة للحديث عن الجولان، وكذلك فعل بالنسبة للأحداث الجارية في الأندف حيث تجاهل الدور القطري في إعطاء تعليمات للإرهابيين بخطف عناصر الوحدة الفلبينية، إضافة إلى موضوع الكيماوي كما شرحت، من خلال أيضا تجاهل أن الحكومة السورية هي التي طلبت التحقيق، والحكومة السورية ما زالت الآن حتى هذه اللحظة ترحب بوصول فريق الدكتور سيلستروم للتحقيق في الكيماوي في أي لحظة. On behalf of my government, Dr. Sellstrom can go to Damascus in an hour from now.
But he wants a larger investigation.
It's not up to him, he wants. It's up to the mutual understanding that we signed with the Secretary General. He should go there based on our request, the Syrian government's request, to investigate the use by the armed groups of the chemical weapons in Khan al-Assal. This is the core issue of the Syrian government's request.
And you don't
It's not him. It's not about him. It's about the mandate that we have worked out with the Secretary General and his assistant, Mrs. Kane. So it's not a personal issue. It's about a fixed mandate within a very determined and specific framework that everybody should be committed towards fulfilling it. But just for your kind information, the Syrian government, as I said at the beginning, was, made the request of investigation to the Secretary General hours after the incident took place in Khan al-Assal. The issue was discussed within the Security Council. Then, out of a sudden, the two delegations, the French and the British, within the close consultations, raised other allegations, according to what they said, related to other locations where the chemical weapons may have been used. When the president of the council at that time, who was the Russian ambassador, addressed the two ambassadors with the following question, when did that happen? Both of them said, 4 months ago. So if they were really sincere and honest, why they didn't raise these allegations 4 months ago? Why they raised the issue during the close consultations when the Syrian government requested the investigation? The answer is one, and only one, an exclusive one. The two governments, the British and the French, didn't want the UN to investigate what happened in Khan al-Assal because they knew who used the chemical weapons. The proof is that recently the Turkish government, as you know, announced that they arrested 12 terrorists from Jabhat al-Nusra, carrying on with them a bottle containing 2 liters of sarin gas, sarin, chemical weapons, the same gas that was used in Khan al-Assal, within the Turkish territories, and they were on their way into Syria to use the chemical weapons. That was a Turkish announcement, but Mr. Taranko didn't find it suitable to mention that.
The Russian-U.S. talks today ended without any agreement. Are you disappointed, or how do you see this as affecting diplomacy on the crisis right now?
We are not yet briefed by the two sides. We don't know what really happened in Geneva. I heard it the way you heard it from both Mr. El-Brahimi and I think Mr. Bogdanov. They said that no progress has been achieved so far. As long as the American administration and the European Union continue to provide weapons to the armed groups, the rebels, as they call them, the armed groups, wouldn't find it suitable to come to the table of negotiations. As long as they would feel that they are backed by countries in Europe and elsewhere with weapons and political support, why should they come to Geneva? They are getting billions of dollars from the Qataris and the Saudis. They are getting the necessary logistics from the Turkish government. And they are getting the weapons from some Western powers. Why should they come to the table of negotiations?
What's your understanding of the evidence that was presented to Ms. Kane, who's a Russian journalist, who said that she had video of it there and said she gave it to Ms. Kane? It seems like they haven't been able to pass it on. Do you understand whether it's gone to Selfie and what he's done with it? And also just on the kidnapping, where you were saying that you provided this information to DPKO, what have they said back to you? If they gave you an answer saying that they found no state involvement in the abduction of these people, is that
thank you very much, Matthew, for raising this question. As a matter of fact, you know this United Nations is supposed to be a transparent body. It is not. It is not. I forwarded an official request to the DPKO, Under Secretary General, as well as to the Secretary General himself, in a written form, asking them to investigate the Qataris' intelligence involvement in the abduction of the Filipinos. Elements in the working in the UNDOF. Practically speaking, and based on the rules and procedures within the United Nations, either one, the Secretary General himself or Mr. Latsous, should get back to me and to my government with a written answer to my written request, saying exactly what are the outcomes and the results of the investigation. The truth is, they didn't investigate. This is the truth. Because had they done it, they should come back to me with a letter or with an answer, with a written answer, saying telling us the results and the outcomes of this investigation. As far as I know, there were no investigation, and nobody got back to my government through my humble person with the appropriate answer. The Qataris and the Saudis, you know, they have inundated this organization with their petrodollars, and they are buying some people in here.
Is there an official document that you've submitted to the Secretary General that people can see, or is there something
Yes, all the official letters we addressed to the Secretary General as well as to the members of the Security Council are there. Theoretically speaking, you should find them in the net, as we say. Just for your kind information, since the beginning of the crisis up to now, I have addressed 408 letters, official letters, to the Secretary General and to the members of the Security Council, in which we described every single detail related to every single issue. Yes. Yes. If you don't find it, give me a call and I will give you a copy of it. Qatari emir or the new emir, the father and the son, the Holy Spirit will come later. They receive instructions from outside. They are not independent, politically speaking. They fulfill others' agendas. They fulfill others' instructions. Yes. I hope he will be different from his father. But he will need the Holy Spirit, by the way. Could you repeat your question, please?
Edward Snowden, the contractor who was accused of leaking intelligence.
This is a domestic issue. This is a domestic issue.
You say that practically the UN inspectors can come even today to us.
Yes.
But you explain that they have to be, they go where they.
No, no, I didn't say that. There is an agreement, mutual agreement, okay, between us and the Secretary General.
I understand.
Yes.
Because this is a stunning situation, that has been for months, where the sitting government asked the UN to investigate.
Yes.
The UN still will not say that it was not able to investigate, it was not able to have to go in the country, because it was not able to go in the place where it chose to go. Now, at this point, where we are today, we have only the United States, Great Britain, and France. They have the proof that the Syrian government has used chemical weapons. We don't have any proof whatsoever that the rebels used chemical weapons. Why don't allow the UN to go there and find out? Why still be detailed?
As usual, all my explanations are crystal cut and clear, as you know. Number one, in a jury, in a court, when you have a jury, if one of the jury's members, one or two or three, do not fulfill the requirements, the judge will ask to replace them by other members, right? Is that right? When France and Britain are deeply involved in forging the terrorism within Syria, helping the terrorists, providing them with weapons and political support, that means France and Britain are not the right suitable powers to intervene with this regard. They cannot accuse the Syrian government of something that they judge, or they call it allegations, they judge the Syrian government of being behind it. They cannot be objective, they cannot be impartial, they cannot be neutral. They are an integral part of the problem, not an integral part of the solution. This is why they have no credibility whatsoever. This is number one. Number two, we didn't say to Mr. Selstrom or to the Secretary General anything beyond what we agreed upon with the Secretary General and Mrs. Kane. And we have written a letter from the Secretary General acknowledging that the investigation should focus on Khan al-Assad. And as I said, when the British and the French governments, or the British and the French ambassadors, came out during the famous session of the Security Council with these other allegations, they had two allegations, now they have nine allegations. So every day they add to it. To say that something happened 4 months ago somewhere in Syria, why don't we investigate it? You know why they want to do that? Because they want to repeat the same scenario that they applied to Iraq in the early 90s. They want to open up the country, all of Syria, to what they call United Nations inspection. Inspection of what? Inspection of what? We have no problem with the inspectors. We have problem with the framework and the misinterpretation given by the Secretariat to the mission that should be fulfilled by Mr. Selstrom and his team. Yes, Talal. شكرا على السؤال. أولا في سوريا يوجد حكومة واضحة الهوية، واضحة الموقف، واضحة الالتزام بشأن ضرورة عقد مؤتمر جنيف. هذا أمر محسوم. ثانيا من الطرف الآخر لا توجد معارضة واحدة، هناك معارضات بالجمع مرتبطة بأجندات وليس بأجندة واحدة، لأن كل من هذه المعارضات سواء في الجناح المتطرف في الخارج أو الجناح المعتدل أو الجناح المتطرف في الداخل أو إلى آخره، كل هذه الأطراف التي تسمي نفسها معارضات مرتبطة بأجندات خارجية تحصل منها على الدعم المالي والسياسي والإعلامي والدبلوماسي، وبالتالي الكرة الآن في ملعب من يرعى تلك المجموعات المسلحة لكي يشكل منها وفدا تفاوضيا يسمي نفسه وفد المعارضة كي يجلس مع الحكومة في مؤتمر جنيف. المشكلة ليست عندنا، المشكلة في الطرف الآخر ومن يرعى الطرف الآخر. واحد. اثنين، مؤتمر جنيف هو فرصة حقيقية لوقف سفك الدماء. لا تذهب إلى مؤتمر جنيف لكي تقول منذ الآن نحن نذهب إلى جنيف لكي نستلم السلطة من الحكومة. أنت تضع شرطة مسبقا بهذا الكلام. أنت تذهب إلى جنيف لكي تجلس على طاولة الحوار مع ممثلي الحكومة التي تملك الأرض والشعب، جزء كبير من الشعب تملك الأرض وتملك السلطة التنفيذية والسلطة الشرعية. أنا أحاكيك هنا، أخاطبك هنا بصفتي سفيرا للجمهورية العربية السورية وليس بصفتي سفيرا لمجموعة مسلحة. نحن الذين نملك الشرعية. نذهب إلى مؤتمر الحوار لكي نتفاوض على وضع حد للعنف بين السوريين أنفسهم بقيادة سورية وفقا لقرارات مجلس الأمن ومهمة الإبراهيمي. لماذا؟ لكي نبني، لكي أولا نشكل حكومة وحدة وطنية تبني مستقبل سوريا بمشاركة الجميع. نحن نريد شركاء لبناء مستقبل سوريا بالشكل الذي يلبي طموح الشعب السوري. لا يوجد شروط مسبقة. تمام صحيح، هذا هو الغرض من الحوار. لا مش مشكلة، لا لا لا، أنت تفترض أن هناك مشكلة والحوار لم يبدأ بعد. أنت لا يجب أن تفترض أن هناك مشكلة والحوار لم يبدأ بعد. يبدأ الحوار، يبدأ المؤتمر، تجلس على الطاولة بطريقة حضارية، تقول ما عندك، نستشف الرأي العام السوري والرأي العام الخارجي، وهناك شهود قوى مهمة ستكون حاضرة، وبالتالي المؤتمر هو الذي يقرر. المؤتمر، المشاركون السوريون في المؤتمر هم الذين سيقررون مستقبل سوريا. لا شروط مسبقة، لا شروط مسبقة، توافقية بين المشاركين الحكومة والمعارضة طبعا. Yes. I didn't say that. I didn't say that. I didn't say that. I didn't say that. I said you cannot hold, you cannot suppose that you could hold an objective conference while you are still providing the other side with weapons. This is what I said. As far as we are concerned at the Syrian government, we will be there. There is no even. There is no even. This conference should be without any preconditions. Number one. Number one. Number two. It's not only about the Syrian government. There will be many governments sitting around the table, and Al-Ibrahimi will be there. So those who will attend the conference, besides the Syrian government representatives, will judge whether the other parties are serious or not. If they continue providing weapons to the armed groups on one hand and ask them to come to the table of negotiations, they will not come. They will not come. Getting billions of dollars from the Qataris and the Saudis and living in this haven, logistical haven of terrorism in Turkey, why should they come? Hezbollah is not part of Geneva Conference. Hezbollah is not a part of the Syrian of Hezbollah is a fixation for others, not for my government. Those who have fixation on Hezbollah are not the Syrian government. We don't have this kind of fixation. Number one. Number two, since the beginning of the crisis, we notified in a written form to the Secretary General and the members of the Security Council about the flux of foreign fighters, terrorists coming across our border with Lebanon, coming from Lebanon into Syria, across our common border with Lebanon. And we ask both the Lebanese government to act appropriately in order to stop this flux of terrorists through the border, as well as to the Secretary General and the members of the Security Council. Unfortunately, once again, in none of the briefings given by the representatives of the Secretary General to the Council with the framework, within the framework of the situation in the Middle East or other items, this issue was mentioned. So we have drawn the kind attention of everybody in this organization at the fact that terrorists are coming from our border with Lebanon, terrorists are coming from our border with Turkey, terrorists are coming through our border with Jordan. Please do something to stop these flows of terrorists. Nothing was done until something unexpected happened, which was the abduction of the Filipinos units in the UNDOF. Then somebody opened his eyes and said, guys, something is wrong. Something is wrong. Why something is wrong? Because something happened in the line of separation related to the Israeli security and the Israeli safety, not to the Syrian safety and security. Then they started moving and acknowledging that elements, terrorists, are operating unlawfully within the line of separation. Otherwise, nobody would move, believe me. I think you are a new journalist or an old journalist? Well, if you are a professional journalist, you wouldn't ask this question.
Well, there are foreign groups that are going on to a legitimate election about a month ago that the rebels were in fact using chemical weapons. And I'm not sure what was the source of your information and why have we heard nothing about that since?
Ask the Secretariat. We are still sticking to our request to the Secretary General to come and investigate. When the Turkish government said they arrested 12 terrorists carrying on with them sarin, the gas, that should be taken seriously, at least by somebody in these international organizations, as long as they are talking about the use of chemical weapons. I mean, logically speaking, somebody should pay attention to this important development. It emanated from the Turkish government, not from the Syrian side. Then when President Putin said that the Al-Qaeda and Jabhat al-Nusra have a secret laboratory to fabricate chemical weapons within Iraq, did somebody ask the question? Have you heard Mr. Taranko speaking about that? The Russian president himself said that in Iraq there is Al-Qaeda and Jabhat al-Nusra are developing chemical weapons. Did somebody here or in the secretariat address the Iraqi government with this information? Something is wrong. Thank you. Thank you.